them to Action chapter number 1 tonight. Action chapter number 1. It is good to be back with you this evening, and I trust that each and every one of you had a good day today, and we certainly did. Enjoyed ourselves very much so, spending time with your pastor. And as soon as we got to that park today, I thought I saw a big elk, and it was just a rock. And then we went around the curb, and I thought I saw a big bison, and it was just a tree. But anyway, I know that you hear my accent, and you automatically think that, well, that's a redneck hillbilly if I ever heard one at all. But I'm a city slicker to the core. I really am. I've got four-wheel drive on my pickup truck, but not because it ever goes in mud. I just think it looks good on the side of my pickup truck. Amen. I'll tell you how much of a city slicker I am. Nikita and I, we were in a little town called Monroe, Louisiana. Now, I lived there when I was up until I was about 10 years old, but years had passed, and Nikita and I got married, and we were preaching there at the Maranatha Baptist Church in Monroe, Louisiana. And we went to a barbecue restaurant one day. The preacher gave us the date ourselves, and we just had a date. And we went to a barbecue, like we went today, that good barbecue. What was that, Spitfire? Sugar fire. Saying it was good. Amen. I was spitting fire after I ate that hot sauce. But anyway, we went to a barbecue restaurant. Before we went through the line, I had to go to the restroom. And I got to just a valley of decision, Brother Hart, when I went to the bathroom, because it's not like 99.9% of all the other bathrooms in America that says men and women. It said rooster or hen. And I'm such a city slicker, I had to go ask a waitress which one I was. Amen. Thank the Lord, I know I'm a rooster. Cock-a-doodle-doo. Amen. Anyway, Acts chapter number 1, stand with me tonight if you would, as we take reverence to the reading of the Word of God. Boy, I'm in church most of my life, and I'm just going to have a good time at the house of God. Amen. And I've enjoyed it very much so, being around your pastor. And boy, it blesses my heart to know, and there's a lot, but it blesses my heart to have been around another young man that is just serving God and living for God, and just the things that his dad instilled in his life. Boy, he's just going on with it, and I sure am thankful for it. There's not nearly as many as we sometimes think, but there's some second generation Christians that almost act like they lost their ball on the playground when they were in fourth grade, and they're still ticked off about it. I'm not ticked off about anything in the Christian life. Amen. God's been far better to me than I deserve, and I sure am thankful for your pastor and his spirit. Acts chapter number 1 tonight, and I'm going to preach on a subject like we taught on in Sunday school on Sunday morning. And I made this statement about prayer on Sunday morning, and I'll make this statement again tonight about soul winning. I'm not coming tonight from an expert opinion whatsoever by any stretch of the imagination. I'm not an expert on it at all. But anytime I hear a message on soul winning, it does two things in my life. It always compels me, and it convicts me to do it more. Amen. And I hope tonight that all of us will be, after this message tonight, we would all be a soul winner for Jesus. Amen. Acts chapter 1, look at verse number 8. The Bible says, "But ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost part of the earth." Heavenly Father, Lord, we love you, and Lord, we certainly thank you, Lord, again for loving us and saving us, being so good to us, dear God. Lord, we thank you, Lord, for the good day today. Lord, we thank you, Lord, for the good liberty that you've given us to preach in this place, Lord, these last few days. And dear God, we do come to you and ask you for that same liberty tonight. We pray, Lord, that you do the work that only you can do. Lord, we pray that you would encourage the discouraged, lift up the brokenhearted. Lord, bring conviction where conviction is needed, Lord. And if there would be anybody lost, we pray that you'd save them by the grace of God. Lord, I pray for my preacher here in just a little while, that you would fill him with the Spirit of God as he preaches the Word of God. And Lord, we'll thank you for all that you do. In your precious name, I pray. Amen. You may be seated tonight. Let me give you just a personal, a little bit of my personal testimony, and I'm going to give you an illustration, and then we'll get right into the preaching of the Word of God. And I always want to make this statement anytime that I allude to the life that I lived before I got saved by the grace of God. I don't want to bring any kind of glamour to sin or Satan. I want my life to bring honor and glory to God. Before I got saved by the grace of God, on August 16, 1998, I was living in a halfway house for drug addicts and alcoholics. I'd already been through 5 rehabs and in and out of jail, and my life was absolutely a complete mess as I was going down a dead-end road of destruction. I about sent my mom and dad to an early grave. And about 6 months before, on February or March of 1998, my mom dropped me off at that halfway house. And what she told me that night, I guess I'll never forget this side of eternity. She said, Chris, she said, you're not going to hear from your daddy and I for some time because we've been getting harassing phone calls from drug dealers that you owe money to. And sure enough, I didn't hear from my mom and dad for about 6 months. And in order to live in that halfway house, I had to go to AA meetings every night and get up and say, my name is Chris Dallas. I'm a drug addict and alcoholic. And on one particular Sunday night, August 16, 1998, I was walking out of that halfway house about to head to an AA meeting, and the phone rang. And I went and answered the phone, and when I answered the phone, it was the sweetest voice I'd heard in some time. It was my mama. And mama said, Chris, she said, your sisters and I found a church we've been going to, and we'd like for you to come out tonight. I immediately agreed to go, not to hear about God, not to learn about the Lord. I could care less about any of that. I simply agreed to go just so maybe I could manipulate my mom and dad and please them that I was in church that night, please my mom that I was in church there that night, and maybe she would be pleased enough to let me get out of that halfway house and come home to live with them. That night, I pulled on the church parking lot, and I didn't care anything about God, but I was soon to find out God cared everything about me. The preacher that night didn't even preach on salvation. He preached on how to get out of financial bondage. And I was in financial bondage, but I was soon to realize that I was even in worse bondage than that. I was in the bondage of sin. And after the preacher got through preaching and folks began to flood the altar and it was at invitation time, there was something going on in my heart, even in a message on how to get out of financial bondage. There was something going on in my heart. And I didn't know what it was called back then, but I know what it's called tonight. It was called good old Holy Ghost conviction. And there was a man that came and stood beside me that night, and he put his arm around me, and he brought me up real close to him. And he whispered these words in my ear. He said, you don't know who I am, but I've been praying for you. And when he said those words, he had my attention, because I didn't think anybody in the world cared enough about Chris Dallas even to mention my name, let alone pray for me. And that night he asked me if he could talk to me in the back of the church. And we went in the back of the church that night where the choir would come out on Sunday. And that night he asked me a question. He said, Chris, he said, do you believe the Bible to be the Word of God? And I said, well, I said, it's been a long time since I've read the Bible. I don't know very much about it. He said, I didn't ask you that. He said, I asked you, do you believe the Bible to be the Word of God? And I said, well, yes, sir, I believe the Bible to be the Word of God. And he said, well, that's a good start to our conversation. And that night, he began to take me on a journey. I didn't know what that journey was called then. I know what it's called tonight. It was called the Romans Road to Salvation. He began to show me from the Word of God, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. He began to show me from the Word of God, for the wages of sin is death. And he began to show me that if a person dies physically without having Jesus in their heart spiritually, they'll die and go to a place called hell. He said, the Bible says in death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. But he also showed me from the Word of God that nobody has to die and go to hell because of the shed blood on the cross of Calvary. He said, Chris, the Bible says, but God commended his love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. He also showed me from the Word of God how it's personal between me and God. He said, the Bible says that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God had raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. And then he showed me what I believe tonight, or what I, in my opinion, is the greatest verse of the entire Bible, in that verse of Romans chapter 10, verse number 13, that says, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And that night, to the best of my ability, I bowed my head, I bowed my heart, and I called on the Lord Jesus Christ to save my soul. And I testify to you tonight, my life has never been the same since that day. And 26 years later, you're just looking at a nobody telling everybody about a somebody who can save anybody. Many people have asked me through the years as I've given my testimony and the reason that I originally went to church. Well, Chris, did your mom and dad let you come back home? And the question is, or the answer has always been, absolutely not. I didn't move. Matter of fact, I never moved back home. It was, my mom cried and she wept and she praised the Lord that God saved me there that night. But she also walked me to my car as I went back to that halfway house that night. Matter of fact, I got in trouble that night from the director of the halfway house because I went to an AA meeting. The very next night, as we were sitting there in that AA meeting, they had the chairs in the circle like they do in AA meetings, and this lady got up and she said, my name is so-and-so, and I'm a dope addict, an alcoholic. And everybody said, hey, so-and-so. And this person got up and said, my name is so-and-so, and I'm a dope addict, an alcoholic. And everybody said, hey, so-and-so. And two or three more, and finally it got to me. And I said, my name is Chris Dallas, and I'm a drug addict, an alcoholic. And I said, but last night, I said, my mom called me. And I said, I hadn't heard from her in a long time. And she invited me to come to church. And to be honest with you, I agreed to go to church, not really because I want to know anything about the Lord. I said, I really went to church, so maybe, just maybe, she would be pleased enough to let me get out of that halfway house and come home and live with them. And I said, but last night after that preacher got through preaching, I said, a bunch of people went down front to around where he was preaching there at the altar, and they began to pray. And I said, there was a fella that came and stood beside me last night, and he put his arm around me and said he'd been praying for me. And last night after the invitation, we went in the back of the church, and he began to share the Bible with me, and he began to show me from the Word of God about the love of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I said, I don't know how to explain it all. I said, but last night I prayed and I asked Jesus to come in my heart and save me. You understand, my dear friend, it was less than 24 hours later that I'd gotten saved by the grace of God. And I didn't have all my I's dotted. I didn't have all my T's crossed. I didn't know any doctrines of the Bible. I didn't know that you pronounced it Job. I still pronounced it Job, my dear friend. But can I say, I do know this, that the very night that Jesus came into my heart to save me by the grace of God, it was laid upon my shoulders to tell somebody else what the Lord Jesus Christ has done in my life. And can I say this, my dear friend, your testimony and your background may be different than my testimony and my background, and praise God that it is, but friend, if you're saved by the grace of God, it's our responsibility to tell somebody about Jesus. I ask us tonight a very sobering question that was asked to me over 20 years ago. Whether it was a bus captain, whether it was a pastor, whether it was a faithful, godly loved one, if the one that told you about Jesus was as concerned for lost sinners as you are at times, would you be saved or would you be lost? Let me lay the foundation tonight for the, let me give the context of the scripture, and then we'll get right into the message tonight. We find here that this text records our Lord's last meeting with his disciples while he was here on earth. And Jesus is preparing to ascend back into heaven to sit down at the right hand of God. And before Jesus leaves, he commands and he commissions his men to reach the world with the gospel. He reminds them of what should be the central focus of their ministry. He reminds them that they are to keep the main thing, the main thing. We understand tonight as we read this scripture here in Acts chapter 1, leading up to verse number 8, that Jesus, even himself, had to overcome some distractions as he gave this instruction to his disciples. In verse number 6 and 7, the disciples, they want to talk about future events. Jesus is trying to conduct the world's first missions conference, and they want to turn it into a prophecy conference. Can I say, my dear friend, you and I, as a child of God, we ought to have a good handle on Revelation, and we ought to preach prophecy every now and then. But we live in a day and age where we'll fill the parking lots with a prophecy conference, and you can hear the crickets chirp in a soul winning conference. Amen. I'll tell you tonight, my dear friend, why America's dying and going to hell is because those of us that are saved by the grace of God, we ought to tell somebody about Jesus. Amen. You know why America is quickly becoming a Muslim nation? I'll tell you why. Because, my dear friend, they're more compassionate about their false God than we are our real God. Amen. I'm getting ahead of myself tonight. I want to get back to this. We understand that Jesus had to overcome those distractions. Jesus tells the disciples that the times and the seasons were not their concern. He began to tell them their responsibility was to be faithful to him and work while they waited. Can I say tonight, nothing has changed. Our duty tonight is not to get caught up in future events or any other theological dispute that distracts us from the main thing, and that is to be a witness for the Lord Jesus Christ in this lost and dying world. My dear friend, we need to be careful that we don't allow the devil to distract us from our very purpose in being left in this world. It's easy for every one of us to watch the news and even see current events that are taking place around the world and lose our focus on the gospel. And Jesus was very clear in our duty. Our duty is to be busy working for the Lord while we wait for him to return. Many people think in this world that we live in, being a Christian, waiting on Jesus means like this. No, my dear friend, waiting on Jesus means like this, like a waiter at a restaurant giving the gospel out to this lost and dying world. Some would ask, well, what is the gospel? Very simply, it's the death, the burial, and the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I'm glad tonight I've got a truth from the dope house to the White House, and that is, I don't serve a dead Christ on a cross. I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever men may say. And according to verse number 8, every believer is commissioned, commanded, and constructed to share the gospel with the lost world. The Bible calls us his ambassadors. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse number 20, now then we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God did beseech you by us. We pray you in Christ's stead, be ye reconciled to God. And Jesus, in his last encounter with his disciples before ascending up to heaven, he could have chosen to talk about anything else in the world, but his last words were a command and a commission to share the gospel. And my dear friend, if it was that important to him, it should be equally important to us. And I understand tonight that I don't have to tell a Tuesday night revival crowd that our country is in bad shape tonight, my dear friend. But I like what Lester Roloff said. He said, if you want to see America saved, then get America saved. Amen. And tonight, let me talk to us for a few more minutes on this subject. The work of a witness. Look at verse number 8 again with me. Can I say number 1 tonight? We have the right message. Amen. We have the right message. Look at Acts chapter 1, verse number 8. Look what Jesus said. He said, but ye shall receive power. After that, the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses. Look at those next two words. Unto me. Amen. Dear friend, can I say tonight, Jesus is to be the sole focus of our message. That has not changed. We are to tell the world about Jesus. The one thing that has the saving power is the message of the Lord Jesus Christ. The Apostle Paul said in Romans chapter 1 and verse number 16. He said, for I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God and a salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. My dear friend, we ought to tell this world about his love. We ought to tell the world about his death and his resurrection. We ought to share the message of the gospel. We ought to tell the world that Jesus will save anybody who will come to him by faith. We're not sent forth to try to impress this world with our knowledge or even our church. What folks need is not the latest Christian sales pitch. They need the message of the gospel in preaching. Sometimes I'll put an illustration in the middle of a message to drive home a point, or maybe some tear-jerking story, and I'm not against any of that, but my dear friend, it's not some tear-jerking story. It's not some magical illustration. What will get the job done every time is the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Every week of my life that I'm at home on Thursdays, preacher's son-in-law now, it used to be his youngest son, and he's got other responsibilities. He's a faithful soul winner every single day. But Liam, his son-in-law, and I go out, and we go make our rounds and our visits, and we go out soul winning. And we're inviting folks to our Victory in Jesus addiction outreach. And I tell a little bit about my story and my heartbeat behind that ministry and getting folks in church. And it never fails every single week that somebody will ask me this question. Well, Chris, what was your DOC? And what that question means is what was your drug of choice? And I don't want to come across like a smart aleck or a jerk, but I've always given the same answer when that question is asked to me. I said, my own wife does not even know the answer to that question. The Bible says neither give place to the devil. And I believe that gives place to the devil, my dear friend, when we glorify and all that. My dear friend, I'm not here to tell this world how great a sinner I was. I want to tell this world how great a Savior he is. Amen. My dear friend, preacher and I have just been amazed at the beauty of this building. And man, I know you do. You ought to never lose your gratefulness for what God has given you here at Lafayette Bible Baptist Church, a beautiful place. But my dear friend, may we all be reminded tonight of this building right here is not for people to drive by out there on that highway and say what a beautiful building it is. I'll tell you what it's for. It's to reach lost sinners with the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Everything around this church is a picture of Jesus. Amen. The reason we have a pulpit is because his name is to be proclaimed. The reason we have lights is because he's the light of the world. The reason we have a songbook is because he put a new song on our heart. The reason we have a door is because he stands at the door of our heart desiring to come in. The reason we have an altar is because there's one mediator between God and men. That is the man Christ Jesus. Amen. We have the right message. About 5 or 6 weeks ago, our college, their Commonwealth, all the college kids, and it was a church event. We had an Each One Reach One where we made an attempt for each person to reach somebody with the gospel. And the night ended with an Each One Reach One revival. And boy, we went into the highways and byways, and boy, we compelled people to come in. And we fill that Spanish auditorium up with college kids and lost sinners. And boy, 13 people got saved by the grace of God there that day. And the next week, my brother-in-law, Brother Mackey, that's here, and my sister were out soul winning, and they were making a visit for a fella. And that person was no longer living there, but he come to find out it was a sober living home. And they began to tell them about our addictions outreach. And boy, we started picking them up. And I'd say 6 or 7 come from that particular place just because of faithful soul winners going by there and knocking on their door. I think 5 of them have already been saved by the grace of God. 2 of them, Charles and Rebecca, have already been baptized. And then Greg and Lucretia are getting baptized this Sunday. Amen. And preacher told me the story of one of our new converts that got saved here just a few weeks ago. He said, preacher said he was in church on Sunday, and he said he could tell that he was shaking hands, telling people goodbye at church. And he said he saw Charles about 5 or 6 people deep, and Charles came up. He said Charles shook his hand. He said, preacher, he said, I just want to let you know I appreciate all that you do for us. You don't have to send those vans out here to come and get us and bring us to church. And He said, it's very evident that you love us and we want to thank you for it. He said, I want to do something for you when I get some money. And he said, I want to go buy me some drawing pencils and some cardstock. And he said, I'm a good artist. And he said, I want to draw you a portrait. He said, matter of fact, and he began to pull up his sleeve. He said, I can draw tattoos. And he said, if you want one, he said, I'll give you one. Amen. He now has an eagle on his arm. He, no, I'm just kidding. Lord, forgive me. I'm sorry. We have the right message, amen. We have the right message. Oh, my goodness. I hope you're accepting membership, amen. Anyway, we have the right message. Number two, we have the right method. Can I say, who in the world needs a TV when you can go out soul winning and win folks to Christ, amen? It's the greatest life in all the world, amen. We have the right methods. That word witness, it literally means those who bear witness to the truth. And Jesus is calling his disciples to tell others about him. This world is full of lies, and to be honest, religion in general is full of lies about Jesus and his way of salvation. My dear friend, I'm not here to tell the world about a religion. I want to tell them about a Redeemer, amen. You understand, religion is man reaching up to God. Salvation is God reaching down to man. And Jesus is calling all of us to do the work of a witness and tell people what we know about him. I ask us tonight, what do we know about Jesus? You say, well, Brother Dallas, I know that Jesus loves me. I know that he saved me. I know that he can save sinners. I know that he's coming for us all someday. Well, let's tell that to the world. Can I say, my dear friend, I love Bible college, and thank the Lord allows me to be a part of Bible college. But we get the idea sometimes that we have to have a degree from a Bible college before we can be a witness for Christ. No, we are commanded to tell the truth about what we know about Jesus, my dear friend. This world is dying and going to hell. And if they get saved, it's our responsibility to tell them about Jesus. Number three, I got to hasten. We have the right message. We have the right methods. And number three, we must have the right mindset. The witness in a court of law is to testify to the judge and the jury. And the witness of Jesus Christ is to testify to the whole world. And that's a big task, so Jesus breaks it down for us. We're to begin close and we're to move out. I've had people tell me after I've preached soul winning, well, Brother Dallas, the reason I'm not a faithful witness is because I just don't come across lost sinners. And I say, you mean to tell me you never go to Walmart? You don't fill your car up with gas? You mean to tell me you ladies just wake up and your hair looks like that? No, I know it don't. I'm married. I know it don't. You go to the beauty shop. John Wesley said this, the world is my parish. And most of us in this room will never go to the uttermost part of the earth. That's why we have missionaries that we will send, and we ought to help them get there, but we can go to our Jerusalem. We can be witnesses to our families and our friends and our co-workers. Back in the old days of revival, those Brush Harbor revivals, they used to not call this the altar. And I understand altar is a biblical word, but they used to call this the mourner's bench, because those old-time saints of God would actually come down to the mourner's bench, and they would mourn and they would weep over the fate of their lost family and their friends and the co-workers. But my dear friend, in the average Baptist church today, the same box of tissue stays on the altar for weeks on end because our eyes have become dry and we become unmovable when it comes to the fate of our lost family and friends and co-workers. And can I say tonight, my dear friend, it's a sad testimony. It is a sad testimony of a Christian when they will post their problems and their playtime and their promotions and their product to the entire world on social media, but they won't go across the street and tell people about the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. Not only do we have the right message, and we must have the right methods, and we must have the right mindset, but can I say lastly, and I'll finish, and probably most importantly, we must have the ministry of the Holy Spirit of God. We may have the right message and the right methods and the right mindset, but fail to have the ministry of the Holy Spirit, and everything will be in vain. Jesus tells us in verse number 8, our help comes from the Holy Ghost. And those people in the upper room, they were promised that the Spirit of God was coming and that when he came, he would fill them with God's power. And when that power came on the day of Pentecost, those terrified disciples who had been hiding in fear from the Jews, they became bold preachers of the gospel of Jesus Christ. I ask us tonight, what made the difference? It wasn't their eloquence. It wasn't their oratory ability. It wasn't their delivery. What made the difference was the power of God in their lives. I ask us, where did that power come from? It came from the fact that they were saved and they were indwelled by the Holy Spirit of God. It came from the fact that they were prayed up and they were clean before God. Can I say, I understand tonight, you see me get loud and get red in the face and foam at the mouth like a St. Bernard with rabies. I understand you see that, but outside the pulpit, I'm a very quiet and very shy person. But my dear friend, and how many times have I been on the platform with the Bible in my hand? And I'm looking at my notes at some anemic message there, and I'm asking myself, how in the world is the Lord going to bless this? And the Holy Ghost of God will remind me, son, you've been up all day praying and begging and asking for my power. Now you get out of the way and let me take over. And child of God, can I say, he won't just do that for the preacher, he'll do that for you as well. Because the same Holy Ghost of God that lives in me and your pastor and that preacher right there is the same Holy Ghost of God that lives in you if you're saved by the grace of God. How many of us tonight know of a family member, a neighbor, a co-worker that's lost and without Jesus? How many of us know somebody? When's the last time you prayed for them? When's the last time you wept over them? If the person that told you about Jesus was as concerned for lost sinners as we are at times, would you be saved or would you be lost tonight? Heavenly Father, Lord, we love you. And Lord, we thank you, Lord, for salvation. Lord, you didn't just save us just to do nothing. You saved us to tell somebody else what you've done for us. Lord, may we be faithful in this matter of soul winning. Bless the remainder of the service, and we'll thank you for it.